When I talk about classical mechanics, the pictures that are intuitively going through your mind are probably like some arrangement of some weird pulleys and then strings, and then masses are hanging from here and here, and then you can put another thing and then something hanging from here and here. Okay. So, of course, these are interesting problems, but we'll not be talking about these things in this lecture. Okay. To give you an idea of what is going to be discussed in these lectures, I can take an analogy of your lessons from ray optics. So I will just try to revisit your lessons from ray optics. So in the ray optics, you first learn about laws of reflection and refraction. So you learn that if an incident light falls on a reflecting surface and it gets reflected, then it obeys certain rules that you call the laws of reflection. Like this angle I should be this equal to the angle this R, that is I equals R. Okay? So this is called the laws of law of reflection. Right? You all remember that. Now, in case of refraction, suppose there are two different media, just call it, this one is air and this one is say, water or something else. And one light ray falls on this one, at an incident angle, say I, and at this gets refracted at a different angle, an angle R, and the rule that connects this I with R is basically the Snell's law, sine I over sine R equals the refractive index of the medium. Now, you know all these things. The thing is, once you know these two laws, now you can think about more complicated arrangements. Suppose if you have a system of lengths, say suppose there is a convex lens here of focal length F1, and then there is another concave lens here, focal length F2, and then there is a convex mirror, a focal length F3, and this is my optical axis. Suppose one object is placed in here and you want to find the image of the object, then you draw the ray diagram, you use these laws, here, okay? And then you find how the rays will be reflected and refracted back, and you probably get certain image over here. Okay? So the thing you are doing is that you are using these two laws, these two basic laws, and you are applying it to a complicated system. Okay. Now, our lecture will be concentrated on these kind of things. So if I do the analogy, if I ask you, what do you use to solve this kind of problem? You will be saying that we basically use Newton's laws of motion. Right? So Newton's laws of motion, mainly the second law, is what you use to solve these kind of problems. The question we want to ask in this set of lectures is that where does this law come from? Okay. So where does these laws originate? Okay. And we will try to get an answer. Okay. That would be the essence of Lagrangian mechanics. If you want to do an optical analogy for this thing here, for this one, then what you do, you migrate from the laws of reflection and refraction to something called the law of least time, or something called the Fermat principle. So the Fermat principle essentially tells you that what light is doing is trying to minimize the time of travel from one point to another. Okay? Now let's find it out. So suppose you are trying to do the law of reflection now. So suppose the light is trying to move from A to B via the surface, okay? And it can take many paths. So this one is one path and this one is another one, okay? And the correct path, apparently correct path, is something where I equals R. Okay? So this is I and this is R. And so I double quote it so that you can get it. So this is my correct path. And I know that somehow light chooses this path, okay? Not this one or not the other alternative one. So Palmer tried to explain why is that, okay? And he came up is that light is moving in such a way so that the time of travel between A to B, between two points, becomes minimized. So if you check these three paths, it's an easy proof. I ask you to do it at your home, but you can check that for this path, the time of travel will be the minimum. And that's why light travels in this way. And that's why also light travels in a straight line when moving from one point to another in a particular medium. Okay. Now, you can also check what happens for refraction. So suppose this is my water again, and this is my air. And suppose the light, I should not have drawn this, light wants to go from this A to this point B. Okay. Now, I want to know that I know that light takes only this path to move from A to B, such that sine I over sine R has the same Snell's law. Okay. Now I ask the same question, why is that? Why doesn't light take a straight line path? So this one would be much shorter apparently. But once I remember that light travels faster in air than in water, then I can try to make a sense of why this bending of light through a medium is happening. Okay. Since light is trying to, since light is faster in air, it will try to adjust its path in a way so that it travels more path in the air and less path in the water. So if it would have taken the straight line path, then it is apparently taking equal path in air and water. Then the light thinks, it says, okay, I can do better. I can move a little farther to the right and I can increase my path through the air and decrease my path through the water. And in the extreme case, it can do this thing. So if you draw a perpendicular from point B to the surface and connect these points, so this will be the extreme case that it has traveling maximum path in the air and the minimum path to the water. But that is not the best compromise it can make. Then it is traveling too much in the air and it is still taking it more time. So the ideal compromise it can make between the paths in air and water is something like this. You can also derive this using basic calculus that if it tries to minimize the time of travel between A and B, the path will be adjusted in such a way such that the angle of incidence and the angle of refraction is basically follows this law, the sine I over sine R is C over V. C is the speed of light in air and V is the speed of light in water. Okay, let's say this. So now, if I now go back to this laws of reflection and diffraction that seem to us quite arbitrary, like two independent phenomena, reflection and diffraction. Once Farmer said this, that reflection, refraction and the path of light, the basic ray optics, are not independent phenomena. They are connected by a single principle, and we call the principle to be the principle of least time. So instead of writing individually laws of deflection and laws of refraction, I can just say what light is trying to do is minimize the travel time between points A and B, okay? So in that way, the laws of reflection or laws of refraction are encoded in a single law, okay? So we will be doing the same thing. So once I understand the origin of the laws of reflection and refraction, the rest of the things, like you get an arrangement of lenses and you find the images, that becomes a mere mathematical exercise where you have to keep track of everything. So drawing this parallel, I just want to tell you, in my lectures, I will not be focusing on this thing, but more on this thing, where the laws of motion, where the laws that that govern the equations of motion actually come from. Okay, once I have a certain unified law, I will be satisfied. Is there a common theme, a common thing in all the laws of motion that I can extract so that the physical principle becomes unified? So I'll be more interested in the laws itself than the application of the laws. Okay, now I will pause for a moment and I will ask you if you have any questions or if you have any trouble to understand what I said, and then I will. Okay, is the screen frozen? Hello? Good. So far, do you have any questions? Okay. Good. So now I will be carrying on. Okay. So you understand the things that we will be covering in this course. We will be covering the origin of the laws of motion and why it is interesting to figure out an independent way of discovering these particular laws. And I will start from something called a variational principle. So let me write it down. Okay. So this is a typical mathematical principle which apparently has no connection with physics, but I promise you I will make the connection very clear, if not in today's lecture, then in tomorrow's lecture. So it's a little game, it's a little fun game that we want to play. And so the statement... Hello?
So I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
So how we know that the law we have found is the origin of the law we have finding out? Maybe there will be a principle which fermat principle based on, or maybe anything else that brings the minimum least time principle.
Yes. Okay. Let me try to address that question. Probably your biggest concern is how do we know that the laws of motion or the equations of motion we find are indeed the correct equations of motion. The main answer is we don't know it a priori until we do experiments. So what I will be trying to do is that, so try to think about it. How do we get laws of motion? Suppose Newton's laws of motion, how do we get those? Because somebody did certain experiments with, say, two balls, the balls rolling on a almost frictionless plane, and they have observed that it doesn't stop, okay? And it almost goes on a constant velocity. Okay, so observing these phenomena again and again, and we find a pattern in those observed phenomena, and then we hypothesize something might be going on behind that. Okay, that's how we discover laws of motion. For example, the laws of reflection and laws of refraction we obtained in that way, because somebody did experiment in light and many people found that once light is reflected from a plane surface, always angle of reflection and angle of incidence are the same. So they now conjectured first, okay, that we have repeated the experiment 1,000 of times, a million of times, so there must be some degree of truth in that. So we what we do is that I say, okay, let this be a rule that whenever light gets reflected back from a plane surface, it might be possible that I is always equals to R. And so far, we have not found an exception. That's why we trust it. Okay, so that's how physical laws goes. I mean, no physical laws, no laws of physics are foolproof. They are approximately true until we find an exception. That's why we migrate from Newton's laws of motion to special theory of relativity. Once we find an exception, we modify our laws. But unless we do not find an exception in experiments, we assume that those laws of motion are correct. Now, your another concern was, what principle we use to find those laws of motion? Okay, is the principle of least action is the only one? Okay, so the answer to that is the principle of least action is the best one we know to figure out laws of motion that gives us some idea about laws of motion. I will be explaining that in a sense and why it is so successful and why do we trust in this particular approach, that this variational principle. Okay. So when do you trust the theory? When you do the experiment again and again, and you do not find an exception, and it gives you the correct results. So what I will do is that we know that Newton's laws of motion work very well in the low velocity range, in the low speed range. So we know that. Now, Newton's laws of motion and, say, laws of electrodynamics, they are well-established laws. We did not find any exception in their respective regimes for those laws. Now, what I will try to do, what kind of variational principle basically gives me that particular set of laws? And then I will try to find out what are the general truths that I can extract from these approaches. For example, if I closed myself in a closed room, I never got out of the room, then could I discover Newton's law without doing any experiment? Okay, that will be an amazing thing if I can do that. And I promise you, my final lecture will be on that one, if I get the time sufficiently on. I would try to convince you that if you start with nothing but symmetry, then Newton's laws of motions are the most natural thing that you would arrive at from mathematical principle. Since this mathematical principle is so strong that it gives us Newton's laws of motion in a so much natural way, we believe that's a crucial point. We believe that this particular principle, when we apply it to more abstract cases, will lead us to the correct laws of motion. It is very important because not in every scenario we can do the experiments a priori. For example, suppose you can do experiments with footballs and cricket balls and these macroscopic things. If I ask you how do electrons behave inside an atom or how do the nucleons behave inside a nucleus, you cannot just hold one nucleon separately and test its equation of motion because that's not practically doable. So what we have to do, how those nucleons behave inside a nucleus or how electrons behave inside an atom, you have to guess. Okay, so what principle would you use to guess the equation of motion in the subatomic regime where your common sense does not apply? Okay, you cannot get closer to the truth if you extend the collision of two cricket balls and you apply it to collision of two electrons, okay? Because electrons behave differently. So because they are so small, right? And then you have to ask what is the most general things that is involved in the collision of two cricket balls that does not depend on the size of the ball, does not depend on the scale of physics that we are interested in. So the most general mathematical truth that is present everywhere, not in the macroscopic regime, but also in the microscopic regime. Okay? Once I get that particular mathematical truth, once I get a feeling of what might be going on, I can write down new theories, believing that this approach might lead to the correct equation of motion. How to test those equation of motion? So once I write down an equation of motion for the electron, and that equation of motion predicts certain behavior of the electron, Now you see that in that experiment. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. If it works, then you have some degree of truth in your way of guessing. If it doesn't work, simply discard that theory. And that's how physics progresses at those levels. So what I am trying to do is to prepare you towards what it feels to discover new laws or to write down new equations of motion using ideas that are common to every physical principle. So I'm not sure, does that answer your question? So do you get a feeling of what I'm trying to do, or does that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So now, as I said, I will be proceeding with the variational principle. Now, the statement of the problem is, suppose I have a two-dimensional plane and I label it, this is my t-axis, okay? Do not associate t with time yet. It's just an arbitrary variable. You can call it x, and x and y. And I will be using q and t so that I can be consistent with notation for what I will be doing in the future, okay? So you can think about it as x and y, okay? It's just like two-dimensional plane, it's arbitrary plane, okay? Now, I fix 2 points, this A, suppose this is the A, point A, which has the coordinates q1, t1, and a point B, which is the coordinate q2, t2, okay? Now, I can ask this question, how should I connect these 2 points, A and B, via a function of t, that I will call qt. So this particular way of connecting A and B represents a particular functional form of qt. You all agree to that, right? So this is a particular way of connecting these 2 points, okay? Let me call it q0t, okay? And I can do an alternative way, okay? And I call it some q1t. Oh, sorry, q1 I have already used. So let me call q prime t, whatever. Okay. Now, these kind of ways of connecting these 2 points have very different properties. Now, I want to ask this particular question. If I define a quantity, an integral, basically, that I call this integral S, which is defined as an integration from point one, say from q1, t1, or to q2, t2, okay? Like basically t1 to t2, and an arbitrary function that I do not know yet, I call it L for fun reason, for now, let's say, okay? And this L, I suppose it's a function of q, the first order total derivative of q, which I represent at q dot, so q dot is basically dq, dt, and in general, it might be a function of time itself. And I integrate between these 2 points, okay? Now I ask the question, what is the particular path such that this quantity, so this gives me a number, right? You see, if you plug in a particular form of qt, then you get a particular functional form of L. And once you integrate, these, you get a number, right? This S is a number. This one is a number. So once you do the integration, you get a number, right? So you choose many different Q, as many you want, and evaluate this particular integration each time, and you get a different value of S, okay? And now you try to figure out what is the minimum value of S. Actually, it can also be maximum, but let's just say for the for the sake of discussion, simplicity of discussion, let's say I want to find the particular functional form of qt such that this integration is minimum, right? And then it only chooses one particular path. I mean, it might not be one, but in usual scenario, it only gives one particular path. Let's say that this Q zero T is the magical path which somehow miraculously minimizes this quantity. Okay. Before I proceed, let me try to distinguish between two mathematical terms. One is called the functional, and another is called the function of a function. So this quantity S, you have already noted that it has the property, if I give a functional form of QT and plug it in here, it provides a number, it gives a spills out a number as an output. Whereas this LQ Q dot T, if you provide a functional form of QT, this L is still a function, okay? Because it is not a number. It's basically a function of a function. So this L is basically the function of a function, but this S I will call a functional, okay? So functional are basically defined as that you provide a function as an input and you get a number as an output, okay? So that is the typical definition of functional. So this S, whatever that is, it's a functional, whereas this L is a function of a function. Okay. Now, my goal in this particular scenario is to find out how to find this correct path. By correct, let me call it, this is correct and inside quote. So this is my correct path. So this correct path has the property that it minimizes this particular quantity. Now, how do I find that? How do I find this Q02? What is the functional form of Q02? How will I find that? For that, we use a trick. Okay. So suppose, now you might be wondering, I could draw many possible paths here. You can draw many weird things. All of them are them are a valid functional form of Q with respect to T. Now, how do we distinguish this Q0 from these two? How do we quantify the distinction between these typical paths? So for that, how I define the deviation of paths. So let me, the deviation from the correct and the code path. So let me try to find out what I mean by that. So let me write down any path. So this is basically any path. I parameterize it as the correct path plus a constant alpha, a parameter alpha better, basically, that alpha I do not specify, times another arbitrary function of eta t. Okay. Now notice this. So alpha equals to zero gives me the correct path Q0 t. That's my correct path. That's the one I want to find out, right? And I parameterize the deviation from Q0 t using alpha. Now this eta t is an arbitrary function, but one thing remains true. As soon as alpha equals to zero, it lands me onto the correct path. Okay. Now, if I use this thing I recall my definition, this S is basically integration from T1 to T2 or point 1 to point 2, L Q Q dot T dt. Now, this one and this one has now alpha dependent. Okay. This alpha I do not specify. And suppose you choose a particular function of eta t, then this s will be a function of alpha, right? Because now you are choosing q to be parameterized in this particular form, and then you are doing the integration. So you are integrating over t, so the t dependence goes away. The only dependence, in I do not specify the parameter, it's only a constant, an arbitrary constant that I keep. And so this S should be a function of alpha. Now, what I can do, I can choose different values of alpha, suppose this is my alpha, and I can plot S as a function of alpha for a particular choice of eta t. So for a particular choice of eta t, I do this, okay? And then I know For sure, if my Q0 is my correct path, if the Q0 is my correct path, then I will get a minimum at alpha equals 0. If I deviate from this, either on the left or on the right, the S should increase in whatever way. So this should be the minimum. So I should get the minimum of that quantity S for alpha equals to 0. You might ask, what happens if I choose a different eta? Let's say I choose the eta prime t. Okay, that will give me a different way of drawing my curve. So, but the thing, the truth remains that for alpha equals 0, it is always minimum. So it might be a different way of S alpha, a different way of presenting S alpha. But the truth remains that it will always have the minimum at alpha equals to 0. Because it doesn't matter if you choose eta t or eta prime t, at alpha equals 0, you always get the minimum at S. Because according to my assumption, Q0t is a path that gives me the minimization of this quantity S. Okay. Now, my next job is to use this. So, of course, now this S is a function of alpha, and if the truth is that alpha at alpha equals 0, S is a minimum, then I must require that ds d alpha at alpha equals 0 equals 0. Okay, so if this is true, I will use this to find Q0t. Okay. Now, I wanted to do this in today's lecture, but unfortunately, it's already almost 12:50. So if you remember, our classes are 50 minutes because the rest of the 10 minutes we needed to organize this kind of thing. So I have to postpone it for tomorrow. Tomorrow, I will start from here and then start.